Welcome to our review of Dubious, a fascinating mashup of light improv role-playing, deception, and deduction from Hobby World and Arcane Wonders, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
Dubious comes from Dave Neal and features striking artwork from Marta Ivana, Anton Kavasarov, Svetlana Pikul, Uldrum, and Oleg Yurkov. If you haven't guessed it, this game originally dated from Russia and has been localized by Arcane Wonders. It plays 3 to 6 players and is better the more people you have at the table. Now, while it says it plays in half an hour, we find people often need more time than that to think and take notes. Our games tend to be closer to an hour to an hour and a half.
Well, the game is listed for ages 13 plus. We could see younger folk enjoying this as well, with the trick being to go through all the occupations and secrets with all the players at the table to make sure that everyone knows what each one means.
Now, in Dubious, each player is handed 2 random occupations and 2 random secrets. They pick one of each of these and come up with a character concept that fits their choices. Each round, a question card is revealed and everyone answers that question in character. After 5 questions, players then guess what occupation and secret every other player has. Players get points for correct guesses and for some, but not all of the other players guessing their occupation and secret. The original Dubious box includes 3 eras you can play in: fantasy, Victorian London, and modern.
There's a lot more in the Dubious box than you would expect, which you can see for yourself in our Dubious unboxing video. This includes modifiable player screens and cards for each era, a thick pad of deduction sheets, and even pencils with decent erasers on them.
The artwork here sticks out to me as it's not really necessary at all in this game, but very cool. Everything's drawn in this like Invisible Man style, where all the occupations are just clothing with no people in them. And even the front of the box is done this style. And then the secrets are all just items, like drawings of things. And it just is great for evoking that feeling of mystery. The rulebook here is solid with lots of examples, including a full round of play, so you can kind of see how the game plays before you get it to the table.
To play Dubious, you first pick which era to play in. As Mo mentioned earlier, there's fantasy, there's Victorian London, which could easily be steampunk, and then there's modern. Everyone takes a large hint card for that era and attaches it to their screen behind which they put their worksheet.
3 era-specific cards are added to the question decks, which are randomized. In each game, you will use 2 physical description cards and 3 standard question cards. Each player is given 2 occupation cards and 2 secret cards from the appropriate era decks.
Each player chooses 1 occupation, 1 secret, notes down both sets of cards on their worksheet, because knowing what occupation and secret you didn't choose will help with the deduction part. Then everyone spends a few minutes coming up with a character.
The first question card is then revealed and everyone writes down an answer for that question. And then players read them off in character in turn order.
While the active player is answering, everyone else should be making notes using what they are saying to try and determine which occupation and secret they have and don't have.
This continues for 5 rounds, each round featuring a different question. Then each player summarizes all their answers, reading off their answers to all 5 in a row, 1 by 1 off their sheet. Everyone then makes a final decision on what occupation and secret they think each of the other players has.
In turn, players reveal their guesses and everyone's actual occupation and secret are revealed. Players get 1 point per correct guess that they made. In addition, you get points for every player that guessed your occupation or your secret, as long as it wasn't everyone at the table. If everyone guessed correctly, you get no points.
The player with the most points wins.
So the key thing that makes Dubious work is this scoring system. Because you get no points at all if everyone guesses your occupation or secret, the whole trick is to not be too obvious, to be somewhat dubious. You also get no points if no one guesses right, so you can't be too obscure either, and that's where the fun is. The sweet spot every player is trying to go for is to have all but one other player guess correctly for each their secret and their occupation.
Some of the red herrings that people throw out can be really amusing. It's part of the fun of this game. I also really like the mechanic where you get 3 occupations to pick from, because you know it's not just, oh, this one will be more fun. You get two to pick from, and you only have 1 that you don't know?
Yep.
Oh, I thought it was 3. But anyways, you have 1 that you know no one else at the table is. You have 1 that you know no one else at the table is. You might want to kind of hint that you are, even though you aren't. It's one of the fun aspects of the game.
Yeah, you want to be helpful, but not too helpful, which can be a hard line to walk, depending on the group you're playing with, you're going to want to think about who the others are and what they might take away from your answers.
Now, a big potential problem with Dubious is the fact the game requires on-the-spot thinking and what actually boils down to light improv role-playing. In this game, you're forced to come up with a character concept based on two things, an occupation and a secret. You're then going to have to answer questions in character based on that concept. This makes it a fantastic game for RPG players, but something that may not be as appealing to people without that kind of experience.
I actually think it's a good intro to the concept of role-playing for some people.
Yeah, if the idea of answering questions off the cuff terrifies you, though, don't run away just yet. As answering as if you were someone else can often help assuage some of those fears. And there's no timer running here, so no concern about that sort of pressure.
Now, personally, I don't have any problem with an improv element. I've been role-playing games for way too many years. And what I like is the deduction part of this game. The doubt sowed by the way people answer the questions is fascinating, kind of as Deanna mentioned. And for the most part, you can use logic, at least to narrow down the possibilities. Like, you might not be able to perfectly lock down your final answers, but you can actually use deduction logic. And the game helps facilitate this by having the reminders right on your sheet, right? That is so useful. You have a list of all the occupations in the game and all the secrets right there. So you know what is right in front of you. And as people are answering, you're looking at that sheet and you're going, oh no, there's no way they can be a grave digger because they said this. And oh, there's no way they're the cab driver because they mentioned they wear a suit to work. And it's really neat the way that works. Plus, there's, as they mentioned, the fact that what role you aren't. I don't know how many times we played this game where partway through someone realizes they have someone pegged for something they can't possibly be because it's the one you didn't take.
As far as the improv anxiety aspect, I think the fact that they have you write down your answer and you don't make you do it on the spot. You have time to think about it. You write it down and then you have to say it out loud and present it to the group. That really helps with that.
So this is where I found the score sheet somewhat baffling, as they had all this room for notes, aside from being able to write down your own questions, which was super helpful. What I really wanted from the guessing area was numbers I could circle or cross off or make little stars around or something. Writing wasn't what I wanted.
Now, what I really like too was the fact there are three eras, right? Three settings, including this box. One of these settings could have been a standalone game. That adds a ton of replayability to the game. Plus, I like the settings are generic enough you can kind of build on them, right? Like when Dan was listening to something, she talked about using London as steampunk. And there's no reason you couldn't say do modern, but say it's modern, but it's during a zombie apocalypse. And that would actually change some of the people's answers. Right. If you're a modern taxi cab driver, what you're wearing might be completely different than what you're wearing during a zombie apocalypse. You could also try mixing and matching stuff, but I got to say that's got to get funky for the hint cards. You probably have to make up your own hint cards that are a mashup of, you know, the fantasy secrets with the modern and doing a Charles DeLint game.
I'm sold. I now want to try the Charles DeLint game.
So while I've only played one era so far, I'm more than comfortable with improv RP, so deciding on my character was effortless, and I was able to spend time on each question crafting what I thought would be the best mix of reality and deception to try and get the right people to guess. Of course, there can be a lot of overlap between the roles and secrets, so what you're sure will be interpreted one way can easily go elsewhere in the mind of others.
Now, longtime fans of the show know I'm not normally a social deduction game fan, so I was leery of this one when we took it home. One of the things that won me over, though, is the fact that it is part role-playing game. I am way more comfortable playing a character who may need to mislead other people than playing a game where I'm forced to directly lie to my friends as me. Added to that is the fact you probably don't have to lie at all, really, because Dubious is more about trying not to be too obvious in misdirection that it is about complete falsehoods. Plus, there's no team here, right? You don't get that werewolf thing of people playing favorites. You're not picking anyone. You're not voting on anything. You're just trying to guess what the other players are. And honestly, this has so little in common with other social deduction games. I don't even want to group them with other social deduction games, but that is where everyone seems to have put this game.
Yeah, when we first got it and you said, it's a game, it's called Dubious, it's a social deduction game, I went, no, why? I don't even want to do that. But it is so much more than that. And I don't know what to call it because it does have a deduction aspect, but it's more of a logical deduction. I don't know.
Yeah, it's hard to place to call this social deduction, despite the fact that it is what it is. But as Mo said, it's just a very different kind of social deduction from werewolf or what have you. I call it the role player's guess who.
Yeah, I could see that. You do. You have all the answers right in front of you, like guess who. I that's actually not a bad bad name for it. I dig it. So while Dubious wasn't what I expected, it ended up being somewhat something perfect for my family, really, honestly. Like, everyone has enjoyed this. My youngest daughter, Jen, has declared this her favorite board game of all time. It is one she keeps asking to play, and every time we're headed over to Brenda's on the weekend, it's, can we bring Dubious? And when we were like, is there anything you want us to bring to our local event at the Walkerville Brewery? She's like, you better bring Dubious. This is great. My mother-in-law also enjoyed it. Like, just a huge range of players. We've had some success with this one out at public play events, where we had a game where, like, the local indie RPG player loved it, along with someone who showed up to an event expecting to play Monopoly. There's a lot more universal appeal to this game than I would have expected.
We kind of mentioned this earlier, but I want to say it again, that the only thing with playing this with younger kids, or perhaps anyone that English isn't their first language or anything, is the game will be ruined by anyone not understanding what a certain role is. So you have to go through and go, okay, do you know what an inquisitor is? Do you know what, do you know what all these things mean? Because the Victorian age one, my youngest daughter didn't know all of those words, or didn't, she thought she knew some of them and didn't have the correct definitions for them. And it did put a kink in her first play of the game.
Totally fair. Now, the only fault I can find really with this game is that I don't know how often I'd want to play it. It does take a bit of the right group and mood, so it's not going to be a game you play every week for a lot of people, I suspect. That being said, I think it really does deserve a place in collection, even if it isn't going to be coming out every single week.
Now, I said I don't really like social deduction games, but I have a feeling, and I don't know this because I don't like them, but I think players who do like social deduction games would love this. Like, I have a feeling if you like that werewolf, if you like the secret whatever, if you're into those kind of games, if you like One Night Ultimate Werewolf or Werewords, I think you'd get something out of Dubious I didn't. And I really think that group of players would dig this game.
If you are a big fan of One Night or any of the group social deduction games and do like Dubious, do let us know. Drop into our comments or into our Discord and give us your thoughts on this game, because as people who don't play that sort of game, we'd love your opinions.
Yeah, I'm super curious about that.
Now, I also recommend this for people who like tabletop RPGs or RPG elements in games. Now, when I say RPG elements, I'm not talking about hit points and levels and armor class. There's none of that here. This is not that kind of game. Even when you play the fantasy setting, you're not going to worry about your inventory. Instead, you're going to be coming up with a character, then answering questions as that character, which in essence is playing a role. This is also going to appeal to drama and improv fans for these reasons.
This is a great game to pull out if your RPG night fell apart at the last minute and with a key player not able to be there.
Yeah, Gwen brought this to her board game club at the high school, and she said it was really popular with the kids that are in the drama program. I'm like, yep, that makes sense.
Yeah, that tracks. As for everyone else, you do or don't like social deduction, you've never played an RPG before, you're not into drama, give it a shot. Just don't expect it to be a party game. That is not what this is. This is... It seems to be put into the party game social deduction category. Everyone tends to think of those as, laugh out loud, quick games. This one does take some time because you have to sit there and come up with characters. You've got to come up with answers. And there is a lot of note taking in this. You are writing down all of your answers. That's part of the game. This isn't a quick filler, but it's also short enough that you can play multiple rounds in a single night.
This has that party game feel to me where I really don't care about the scoring as much as I should. Maybe I know being able to trick people and getting those points is part of the fun of the game, but it's more just about the experience of sitting down and playing the game. So, sit down, take your time, enjoy it. Yeah, I don't think it's going to fit that 30-minute box time. It's going to be more like an hour, but it's an enjoyable hour.
Now, as for me, I recently learned there's a follow-up to Dubious coming. Dubious New Realms. It's going to have three new settings, more occupations, and more secrets. And I am really looking forward to playing a sci-fi themed game of Dubious. Now, the other two themes in this box will include Antiquity, which I know will appeal to Deanna, And for the rest of the world who absolutely adores it, there will be a Cthulhu Mythos version.
2 out of 3 ain't bad. I want it.
So what I want to know is, where's Super Dubious? Villains, heroes, henchmen, sidekicks, pesky reporters. There are so many options right there.
So Dubious, even more new realms. if you're listening, Hobby World, we would love to see a super version.
I want more questions. That's what I want them to add in. And I know there'll probably be more questions that are for those themes, but I would like more questions to add into each theme because I felt like there was not quite enough variability there.
Actually, that'll be interesting to see because Dubious New Realms is a standalone game and should have the generic questions that you use every game. I wonder if they'll be different than the one in this set. And if they are, then you can match the two together.
That would be great. So that's it for our look at Dubious from Hobby World, localized to North America by Arcane Wonders. It's a fascinating mashup of board game and RPG that hits all the right spots for us.
We love seeing the RPG and board game worlds collide. What's your favorite board game that includes role-playing elements? Or other ways around, what's a TTRPG that features some cool stuff from the world of board gaming?
Let us know in the comments. Send me an email to mo@tabletopbellhop.com or hit me up on social media where I can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Support the Tabletop Bellhop by joining our Patreon. You can find it at patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. There you'll find some public posts like announcements and upcoming show topics, but the good stuff, like the first thought reviews and bonus audio, are saved for patrons only.